ورجعنا لكم دلوقتي بعد الفطار صوما مقبولا. احنا قلنا في possibility لفور possible diagnosis pulmonary arterial hypertension with complication right sided failure. عندنا right sided failure by tachypnea and tachycardia due to the congenital heart disease. No, there is no murmur apart from the murmur of the tricuspid rigor due to the pulmonary hypertension. يبقى congenital heart disease is excluded. The second option, pulmonary arterial hypertension with right-sided failure. عرفت ان هو pulmonary arterial hypertension by accentuated S2 and murmur of tricuspid rigor and the patient has right-sided failure with tachypnea and tachycardia and enlarged liver without chest or upper airway problem. There is no wheezy chest, no snoring, no problem in upper airway. The third possibility is a pulmonary arterial hypertension with right-sided failure without cause. Yes, it is an idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension, and we return back for the definition of what is meant by pulmonary arterial hypertension and idiopathic cause. And there is no positive family history for this case, so we exclude the fourth case, fourth possibility. I give a few words about the fetal circulation. We know that the right ventricle is the main and the pumping of about 60% of a cardiac output in utero. And by expansion of the lung during birth and the entry of oxygen and the mechanical stretching of the lung, there is gradual decrease of the pulmonary artery pressure. And we should notify that pulmonary artery pressure didn't return or couldn't return rapidly and could expand up to 6 weeks following delivery. And pulmonary artery pressure, what is the normal pulmonary artery pressure in neonatal period? It should be less than half of the systemic pressure or more than 40 to define mild pulmonary hypertension in neonatal life. So pulmonary arterial hypertension is defined if we have a mean arterial blood pressure or mean pulmonary artery pressure more than 25 millimeter mercury, which is measured by CAS, and the wedge pressure should be less than 15 millimeter mercury. Actually, in our practice, we didn't catheterize all of our patients. And according to the Fifth World Symposium of Pulmonary Hypertension, NICE 2013, we have five classes. The majority of pediatric population is within the first group, either is idiopathic form or associated with congenital heart disease or persistent pulmonary hypertension of newborn. Our patient is idiopathic. There is no cause for this elevated pulmonary artery pressure inducing right-sided failure. There is no left-sided lesion, so it is not the group 2. And there is no chest problem and upper airway obstruction, so it is not the third group. And there is no history of thromboembolism, and the diagnosis of this group is so difficult and rare in pediatric population. And the fifth group associated with miscellaneous like systemic lupus or hematological problem or sickle cell disease. And as I mentioned, if we have pulmonary artery pressure systolic more than 40, we categorize this patient as a mild pulmonary hypertension and should be more than 2/3 of the systemic blood pressure, especially in neonate. And if it is suprasystemic, more than suprasystemic pulmonary artery pressure, it is severe form. The burden of pediatric pulmonary hypertension is very high and with significant morbidity and mortality. And as we mentioned, as we know, that pediatric population is not a small adult, And even the diagnosis of idiopathic pulmonary hypertension is somewhat difficult. And that is why I am highlight this case. It could present by abnormal presentation like abdominal pain or vague manifestation like seizures. And there are many contributors for a pediatric pulmonary hypertension in a pediatric population, mainly the chromosomal and genetic syndrome and abnormality of lung or lung hypoplasia and other associated disease. We know that syndrome like Down syndrome, DiGeorge, Scimitar, and Noonan syndrome are very common associated with pulmonary arterial hypertension. The majority of pediatric pulmonary hypertension is either due to the congenital heart disease or idiopathic and rarely associated with thromboembolic manifestation or thromboembolic disease or connective disease. It's very important to know the class of pulmonary arterial hypertension, as with idiopathic pulmonary hypertension, the prognosis is much more worse compared to pulmonary arterial hypertension secondary to congenital heart disease. As we mentioned, that this patient has inability to express himself, and even the symptomatology and sign are very, very misleading. And to risk stratify and to give a proper prognosis and the possibility of mortality within 1 year, according to European classification or risk stratification, we depend on clinical evaluation if there is a sign of right-sided heart failure, if there is a syncope, and according to the WHO classes, by doing a 6-minute walk test and by doing a pronatretic peptide, we can categorize our patient as a low risk by mortality less than 5% or high risk if it's with mortality more than 10%. And our goal of treatment for pulmonary arterial hypertension is to reduce and to do a pulmonary vasodilatation and to reverse remodeling and unload the pressure in the right ventricle and support this right ventricle and avoid ischemia and heart failure and to improve the exercise incapability for this our patient. So to summarize our patient, Mustafa had idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension, group 1-1, presenting with non-specific symptoms, and symptoms are severe at the time of diagnosis, and systematic or systemic investigation are needed to diagnose the class and to do a risk stratification. And we manage this patient by diuretic and digoxin, and by doing a targeted pulmonary hypertension therapy by sildenafil and bosentadine, which is endothelin receptor blocker, and oxygen therapy. And we are by following our patient by pronatretic peptide, this enzyme dropped from 15,000 to 3,000 picogram per ml. So we are doing a great job and great work by properly investigation and properly diagnosis early to know the prognosis of our patient. Thank you.